where there was something kind of wrong because I was surrounded by crying women.
How long has this journey been for you? How long has this...
Well, I mean, it started probably about, it's probably about a year ago we got noticed that we'd gone into Sundance. So that's, so in terms of the kind of journey post finishing the movie, it's been about a year. But you mean...
The very beginning was...
I think the very beginning was reading about him, about the imposter. And that was probably like nearly 3 years ago or so. Not that I kind of acted on it immediately. I found an article in a Spanish magazine which had been gathering dust on a friend's coffee table.
Mm-hmm.
It was in Spanish, and I kind of made a note to myself. I just read about, because he was already known in France as the chameleon, and I thought something kind of extraordinary about this story of a guy who had impersonated so many destitute children and had literally covered the length and breadth of Europe, having stayed in children's centres all over it. And so I kind of made a note to follow up on it, and then sort of forgot about that, and then found the note some months later and did a quick Google search, and then and that threw up a couple of these quite amazing articles which went into detail about the incident, which becomes the focus of the film. And so that, so you know, that probably was at least sort of 3 years ago, and then took a while, made contact with him, in the end brought him to London, shot the interviews, and then let that alone and kind of got on with other stuff, and then came back and cut a 4 or 5 minute promo from the interview that we did with Border, with the imposter, and got the finance. And so probably that, you know, in the making of the film was probably a good year of solid work spread over two, and then finished it almost exactly a year ago.
Mm.
So it's been kind of a wild time since then.
So when you shot him initially, did you have a sense of what you wanted to do with a story? Or you just wanted to get his story on tape?
I didn't have really a sense, but I also, there was a sense that he was kind of unpredictable. He wasn't necessarily the most kind of dependable contributor, you know, surprisingly. And there was a sense that if I didn't kind of commit to bringing him and shooting that interview, then we wouldn't start the process, and before long, because first of all, I couldn't believe that no one had made the film, you know, either a sort of fictionalized version or the documentary. And so felt like, and as it turned out at the time, even though this was years after the event, other producers were sniffing around the story. Someone even, I think a Texan company had paid him quite a bit of money for his story, and then he disappeared on them. So it sort of felt like, right, let's bring him to London, shoot the interview, and kind of figure out what the film was going to be. Because I wondered whether the film was going to be about him, or whether he was going to be a way into a more interesting, a bigger story. Which ended up being the case. But I normally would prepare for, you know, weeks for an interview like that, but didn't really have the time. And I kind of always thought I would go back to him, but never needed to.
Because it's interesting, I mean, I guess Errol Morris on his last film, this crazy woman, Joyce McKinley, I mean, you see the film and it's this kind of reaches over decades, and it turns out he shot her the one time at the beginning and then built the whole thing around her. It's, I think, shocking how well a film can come together, as yours does also.
Yeah, I mean, I think I realized that it wasn't going to be a kind of an investigative film in which, you know, I would do an interview with him, then I'd do an interview with someone else, and then I'd confront him with, you know, the things that didn't add up, that were that came from another interview. And actually, it kind of became clear to me that really it was more about allowing all of these different voices to tell their subjective version of this story, and for me to try and navigate my way and I guess the audience's way through that. But yeah, no, never went back to him, and also started the interview at the very beginning of his life with his birth, and kind of went through to sort of the present day, and then realized later that actually, you know, I kind of wanted to start the story at the point at which the phone call gets made, and the whole kind of machinery of the lie starts kind of snowballing.
So was the notion of giving away the ending essentially about, you know, not creating this, you're creating a mystery and yet there's no mystery because there's the guy.
Well, as in the revelation of him being an imposter.
Yes.
Yeah, that was something I thought about, and it was something that we discussed, you know, in the edit suite, and you know, this idea that actually should the entire story be told sort of from the family's perspective, and then the revelation be that it wasn't their son after all. But I think, well, I think there are a number of kind of, I felt there were a number of problems with that. I think one, I didn't feel like that was the revelation. I felt that, you know, on a practical level, the thing about that is that if you do that at the point, you kind of can't introduce him into the film until you've revealed that it's not Nicholas Barkley. And at that point, you then have to kind of, you've got this big question over his motivation, his reasons for doing it, and how it all happened. And then if you structurally then rewind to the beginning and tell his side of the story, you've already kind of given away the fact that, well, he gets to America, he convinces that, so you've already kind of sort of I suppose thrown away the tension of knowing, which I think the audience is asking themselves for the first sort of 30 minutes of the film, you know, where is this going and where is it going to end? And you kind of have this sense of a lie which takes on a momentum and a scale that probably he never even intended, you know.
Well, it's a fascinating, I mean, it sounds kind of like you guys ultimately made it an intellectual choice to how, you know, how could we make this story work? What was the only real option without becoming so complicated that it become not interesting?
Yeah, but it also, it was really about trying to understand kind of how the whole thing happened and how he was able to do what he did. And a big part of that, I think, for me was this idea that, you know, when you sit down with the imposter, with Frederick, in his version of the story, you know, he's the victim. And what is kind of amazing is how quickly you, as a human being or as an interviewer or a documentarian, are kind of seduced by that logic. And so the moment that I realized that I was kind of, that in my mind he was becoming the victim, I suddenly realized, well, he must be doing to me what he does to everyone, which is kind of convincing people that he is, you know, that he's the victim. And so I thought, you know, there's something really interesting about this, you know, the way in which to make this film a very different kind of documentary is to allow him to do to the audience what he kind of does to everyone, which is sort of manipulate and tell this incredible story and invite you to sympathize with him and you know, so you see him in all his different forms, because he is very intelligent and he's very seductive and he's very convincing and you know, and also very manipulative.
Well, it's a strange feeling because you watch it, I think, and you don't quite, you're watching it happen. You're being told how he did it. And at the same time, you don't quite believe that it can be that, it's that clear. You know, it's like you almost believe like there's going to be another twist in this that's got to be there that isn't really there. It's just, it's that wild, it's that real, and it's that crazy. But somehow you it's like watching a movie where the guy at the beginning says, you know, I'll be dead at the end of this movie, and you're kind of thinking, well, how's he going to stop being dead? You just don't really buy in because it is so charming and he is so...
Yeah, and it was important for me to kind of allow him to have a fairly direct contact with the audience, you know, so that you realize at a certain point that, you know, probably he is not... You know, I think you realize right from the very beginning that he's not a terribly reliable witness and he's not a credible narrator. At the same time, you still go with him on that journey quite willingly and knowing that kind of it's inexcusable. But, you know, he also tells you his reasons for doing it, and I think some of those are very kind of persuasive.
Well, I think the flip side also of the family is that you end up, part of the thing of the movie, I think, ends up being what is a victim?
Yeah,
because the family doesn't seem quite as victimized as you might imagine if you were in that position and somebody was doing this to you, how bad it would be. doesn't feel quite as horrifying to them as you would expect, I guess.
Well, I mean, I think that's what, you know, what I was talking about this idea that, you know, not knowing whether the film was going to be about him,
mm-hmm.
and I think he'd love to believe that it is, but I'm not sure it is really, you know, or whether the story was going to be a kind of a way into this other kind of bigger idea about, you know, which is as much about self-deception as it is about deception, you know, about, you know, this idea that, you know, is the truth ultimately what we choose to believe rather than mm-hmm. reality, if you know what I mean.
But they are kind of like, and not a, they're less sympathetic, I think, than you would expect, which makes it more interesting in a way.
Yeah, I mean,
they're somehow settled in a way that you would expect, you know, to be more angst, more, you know, screaming or more rage or more passion about both the loss of the child and the deception. It's just an odd thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to know really, because I think people have very wildly differing reactions to that. I mean, that's the amazing thing, you know, listening to people coming out the cinema, you hear couples arguing very kind of animatedly about, you know, normally it's the blokes who are feeling what you're feeling, which is that, you know, there's something, why aren't they more emotional? And then it's the women who are kind of feeling that they are sort of willfully self-deluded, you know, willfully mm-hmm. blinded because of grief, because of, you know, bereavement or the need to believe something that can't be true. So it's a kind of complex thing. You know, we had a screening last night and, you know, the audience was very polarized mm-hmm. about what they thought, you know.
Well, the time difference is also pretty significant in terms of the storytelling. I mean, yeah. To have the child be gone for that long, to be disappeared for that long and then have him come back is a lot different than, you know, 2 years later or 6 months later.
Yeah, I mean, it's still, you know, it's still hard to imagine that, you know, after 4 years that he, you know, his return, you know, of course he would have gone through puberty while he was away potentially, which maybe explains some things, but of course, you know, not the fact that he had a thick French accent and, you know, dark hair and dark eyes and all of these things, which kind of to us seem laughable, you know, and absurd, mm-hmm. but at the same time, you know, I suppose there is that question of, you know, if you need something to be true, if you desperately need something to be true,
mm.
are you capable of blinding yourself to the glaringly obvious? You know, so I guess that's one of the questions at the heart of the film.
So the movie certainly gets laughs along the way.
Yeah, that is actually something I was quite surprised about. Because in the UK, people don't laugh like even a fraction as much as they do here. And I think maybe there's a kind of cultural reference point that, you know, is not, you know, I think in the UK we don't necessarily make this difference between Texans and, you know,
mm-hmm.
people from California or, you know, and I think here, you know, I remember when we screened it for the first time at Sundance, there were a lot of laughs in places that I was kind of shocked by and mm-hmm. and didn't really want people to laugh either, you know, mm-hmm. it was kind of a weird thing.
So when you were cutting it together, once you had kind of figured out what film you were going to make, did you feel like it was a risky proposition? Did you feel completely confident that you know, were on the right path and this was going to work out? Or
I felt confident that the story was exceptional enough to and compelling enough to work as a cinema documentary. And actually, I kind of wanted to set out to make a film where people who wouldn't necessarily go and watch a documentary in the cinema would be drawn to this, because I kind of felt like it should be academic, that it's a documentary. Of course, you know, it's rigorously researched and journalistically very, very kind of intensively sort of investigated, I suppose, but at mm. the same time, structurally, it plays out like a thriller. Filmically, you know, it looks like a film noir. It sounds like a, you know, a movie. I felt like they're, you know, fictionalizing it wouldn't make the story better. In fact, it would detract from it, and mm-hmm. it would make it less believable. And so I sort of felt like it was a good bet, and but of course you never know. I mean, you know, it would have been embarrassing to have completely cocked up a story which is as extraordinary as this one, you know.
But you made strong choices. It wasn't like you were making, you know, just throwing it out there. I mean, were you ever concerned about that, or did you just kind of feel it was going the right direction? You could see you're coming.
Yeah,
together?
I felt like, you know, the kind of unusual thing about the story is that it kind of feels like it exists. Do you want me to?
No, it's okay.
Let me
just finish it. Hang on.
There you go.
I like that he's your screensaver.
You are, I think. Yeah, it felt like a story which kind of like had half a foot in the real world and then half a foot in a Coen Brothers film or something. Mm-hmm. And so I felt like, you know, visually and structurally, I kind of wanted to reflect that in some way. And even there were times when some of the characters are talking about the story and it feels like they're recounting the plot to a movie. And so I felt like, you know, I wanted to create a sort of a visual language which spoke to that in some way, you know, that you're, you know, and also the idea of using dramatizations, which a lot of people have problems with in documentary and, you know, and probably rightly so in some instances. It wasn't about trying to reconstruct something. It was about creating a sort of interpretation or a visualization of the story that you're being told. You know, you've got these different subjective versions, and so the drama is intended to make you aware that you're not watching a reconstruction, you're not watching a reality, you're watching what this person wants you to believe is a reality, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. So had you shown it to an audience of any kind before, outside of your peers?
Not really, no. I mean, we'd had a couple of sort of very small test screenings for kind of, you know, friends and stuff like that. And knew that it provoked strong reactions and that people seemed to be incredibly gripped by it, and there was a lot of very kind of vocal debate afterwards, so it felt like there was something that looked like it was it was the right kind of reaction, but not hadn't, you know, until we got to Sundance, hadn't really seen it with a proper big audience of hundreds of people.
So aside from the laughs, what was that experience like when you finally put it up in front of that crowd?
It's amazing, you know, because, you know, I've worked in TV a lot before, and you can have millions of people watch the film that you've made, but the difference is they're not all sat in the same room, you know, and when you watch something with a huge audience and they're all kind of holding their breath and you know, gasping or, you know, crying or whatever it is, it's a really extraordinary experience, because it's kind of like theater, and, you know, and I've always been much more in love with cinema than TV, so that was a really kind of amazing moment, I suppose.
And did you know you had them through the movie? You kind of could tell,
yeah,
that they were
definitely
digging into the right places.
Totally. I mean, you know, and just the body language of watching the audience who all sat forward, you know, all of those things that you kind of think, yeah, and it was just kind of dead silence and, yeah, the occasional unexpected laugh.
And at that point, do you feel like you've, you know, won the World Series? What's that?
I think there's been, you know, there's been a lot of amazing moments. You know, certainly the movie in the UK was a big film, you know, and it was received incredibly well and did very well commercially. And that was, that was gratifying because, again, like, you know, like I said, I wanted a non-documentary going audience to find it. And, you know, and a few awards and things like that. So it's all been, it's been good because, you know, it's these are small budget movies, you know, that you kind of make really out of love rather than anything else, and a belief in the story and the way in which you're trying to tell it. So when it comes off, I guess it's rare and it's a good thing.
So do you become James Marsh now? Is that the the pecking order? Is that you now have to do features and non-doc features?
Yeah, I mean, I've had a lot of interesting conversations and lots of scripts, some of which interesting, by far the majority are not. You know, I'm not really terribly worried about documentary or kind of fiction. I sort of feel like there's enough kind of amazing stories out there in the real world without the need to fictionalize. But at the same time, it's just about the right way of telling that story that you're trying to tell. So doing something totally scripted is something that appeals to me. And also this hybrid thing of finding true stories and reminding people that it's true feels kind of important, you know, preserving the truth of a true story. Because once you fictionalize it, I think you maybe lose something of what's so amazing about documentary, which is that it tells you something you kind of didn't know about what human beings are capable of or whatever. And so I am interested in scripted stuff, but I also am interested in this sort of half uncategorizable world where it's a true story and you preserve those elements of truth, which I think in many cases are what makes a story so amazing.
What's kind of interesting in that, we were just talking to some sound guys yesterday, I guess, actually, maybe 2 days ago, and they were talking about how, you know, the kids today have the digital cameras and that they, you know, there's a lack of restraint. There's a there was a preciousness in the past to getting, once you got something on film, that it was, you know, you only had a few takes, you were, you know, limited, and that there was something compelling about that reality. And in your case, in this film, it seems like the idea that you got this interview, you did this interview, and then kind of the universe of your film rotates around it. Having other options, having, you know, or creating things the way you do in a fiction film, would seem to be, it seems like that worked, this worked for you in this case, that you had the limitation of truth.
Yeah.
Or his truth. You know.
Yeah, it's interesting because there were times when we would get notes on the film, which would be fine if you were making a scripted narrative drama, because you're not limited by the actual events. So, but for a documentary, the notes were not appropriate because you can't change that or make that more, you know, something or less something. You know, you know, there is an obligation to be, you know, true to the events as they've been described or, you know, as you understand them, I guess.
Well, you only have the footage you have, ultimately.
Yeah.
I mean, was there more sense of crafting what the film would actually be as you went to Texas and things like that, as you went on to do other interviews for the film?
Yeah, I mean, there was definitely, you know, there was definitely a point in the making of the documentary where we felt like we were in some kind of detective story ourselves, because, you know, it's quite a bizarre experience if you're, as a documentary maker, that you do one interview one day and you think you understand what went down.
Right.
The next day you come away with the completely opposite conclusion. So those twists of, you know, understanding, those kind of one revelation, then another truth that completely supplants it, was something that I really wanted to try to recreate in the structure of the film, that you as an audience member would, you suddenly discover something and then immediately as you felt like you understood it, it was gone and another truth has replaced it. And that's quite a, you know, a confusing thing. And I and at the same time, I felt like it would be a mistake to try and make a judgment and then set out to prove that judgment,
right,
because that would be, you know, I don't think that would be that wouldn't be authentic to my experience of making a film, which was that there was no kind of perfect answer. There was four or five conflicting versions, you know.
Well, I guess in a fictional film that you know, say, well, nobody will ever believe that if we put it in the film, and then if it was true, it's hard to argue with it.
Yeah, a lot of people have said, why didn't you just make the, you know, the scripted version, and that, you know, the truth is 'cause you wouldn't believe it, you know.
Yeah. So, what is the evolution of you as a documentarian? When was the, was there a moment when you said, "Mommy, Daddy, I want to be a documentarian"? Or,
I think I always, you know, I did languages. I studied languages, and partly because I always wanted to travel and I wanted to put myself in places I didn't necessarily belong. And, you know, I think that's the thing about, you know, documentary making, is that if you're interested in people and you're kind of, you know, being a documentary maker basically puts you in places and introduces you to people that your normal life would never have kind of brought you to.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an amazing, you know, so if you're interested in travel and you're interested in human beings and story, it's like the ultimate. You've got everything, and you're sitting in a trailer park in West Texas or in a prison in Latin America or whatever, and you know, suddenly seeing sides of life that you don't really belong in, you can't relate to. And so I think I always felt incredibly drawn to that, and also drawn to, you know, telling stories and finding innovative ways of doing it. And so I felt like that, so that meant that kind of being a journalist or a documentary maker was kind of the perfect thing.
Mm.
But also being a very visual person, wanting to have a way of not being limited by the form of documentary that I think people sort of feel like there are a certain set of very prescriptive rules which a documentary has to kind of adhere to, and I'm not sure that I agree with that, really. Mm. I think it's a broader church than that, you know. And I agree that, you know, certain things are absolutely critical to preserve, but a lot of people object to the idea of drama in documentary. But, you know, really the story has to be the starting point, not the rules, and then applying the rules to every story that you've ever come across.
Well, some people are more strict than others, I guess.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a very, it's always an interesting controversy, because sometimes it does seem to cross the line and be a problem, and then a lot of the time it just seems to be not the old traditional style of, you know, letting the camera roll and putting it on screen.
Yeah, I mean, you can't do that observational style of letting the camera roll if you're telling a story which happened 20 years ago.
Right.
You know, and if you don't have masses of archive for that, you know, in the way that a film like Man on Wire did and Capturing the Freedmans and all of those, mm-hmm. then, you know, you work in a visual medium, and if you don't want to be, then you should be making it for radio, I guess. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there are realities of, you know, how you need to tell a past tense stories. Some of those require dramatization. But I agree with you, you know, I think where it's problematic is where you're telling the audience that it's something that it isn't.
Right.
You know, so there are quite famous cases of people who've recreated something and presented it as a piece of archive.
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of, you know, that's basically lying. And I think that is problematic. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's an interesting thing, because it's become more and more of an art form. I think as the years have gone by, it's, you know, it's become less about just documenting reality. And, you know, many interesting filmmakers who are even, you know, like guys like Errol Morris, who are extremely popular and well-respected, and yet still there's still a resistance.
Totally.
In the documentary.
But then you've got Argo, which is based on a true story, but right. of course full of Hollywoodized scenes and mm-hmm. all of the rest of it, and, you know, but of course it's presenting something as a true story, but yet there are lots of fictionalized elements in it. And I think I'm not quite sure why that is, you know, there's no sort of objection to that, and why should there be? But then there's an objection to people taking documentary and taking something which, and they are trying to be absolutely faithful to the events as they are
mm-hmm.
recounted. And then they are using, you know, imagery to represent those or illustrate or interpret those things. I don't, you know, I feel like there's a slightly kind of muddled bit of theorizing in there somewhere, you know.
Well, I used to always think of it as a certain amount of arrogance, that the idea that somehow, well, we can see that film and understand what's real and what's not real, but regular people, they'll just be confused and never be able to figure it out for themselves.
Yeah.
And I always find that kind of disappointing, because I think the audience is always underestimated. You know, they don't always show up for everything, but when they show up, I find that audiences tend to get it.
Totally.
Much more so than the intellectual types
think they're going to do. I completely agree. I think that was one of the biggest sort of revelations of this whole process, is how, you know, if you do something really respectful of the audience and really give them credit for having the same intelligence that you think you do, they absolutely will, and they will come to it. And, you know, everyone seemed to understand what I was trying to do with the imposter, with, you know, that, you know, and some people kind of question, well, why would you give someone like that a platform for telling that story? But the reality is until you do that, until you put the audience in a position where they see how he does what he does, or they're on the receiving end of him, you can't understand how the authorities, the FBI, the family, you know, the State Department, all of these people, care workers and stuff, fell for the manipulation or the lie, because until you experience it, mm-hmm. you get a very different kind of insight into that story. So I think, you know, I agree with you. I think, you know, you know, audiences should be credited for absolutely getting it, especially now when people are so literate.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, actually, I think it's an interesting time in documentary in that we have, in many subjects, not in your particular film, but in things like The Cove, for instance, where, you know, there are 3, 4, 5 films being made pretty close to the same subject with some of the same players, and you're getting, you know, 5 different filmmakers' perspective on that same issue. And it's almost like you, to really understand it, you need to see all 5 and then make your own decision about how they fit together.
Yeah.
But that opportunity to have all 5 and to get, you know, accept the idea that filmmakers have a point of view and totally. Should just embrace that and deal with what that filmmaker made and not some idea of what you thought they should have made,
yeah,
is great.
Totally agree.
It's an opportunity. So do you feel a pressure to recreate the success of The Imposter now? Is there a...
Yeah, I mean, I'm working on another story, which is also a kind of... fits into the category of, you know, if it wasn't true, you wouldn't believe it sort of thing. And again, I'm interested in this notion of, you know, the way in which, you know, we tell true stories and keep and preserve the truth of it and keep the audience aware of the fact that this really did happen in the real world, and at the same time bring an audience that might be frightened of a documentary or a movie with subtitles or a movie in black and white, whatever. So I kind of feel like, you know, there's a way of doing that without compromising your responsibility towards the truth, the documentation of those things.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose the question is it as amazing a story as The Imposter? Does it have the potential to speak to themes which are as interesting or revelatory? I'm not sure. That's the next part of the process of kind of digging down into that. And I guess if it doesn't, you know, I kind of won't do it. And if it does, then hopefully it will, you know, whether it'll be as unusual, I'm not sure.
Well, I mean, so you actually feel you wanted film to be as good or better in perception, I guess, as this film. I mean, it's an interesting thing because, like, not every story is going to be that coming yeah. together of all those pieces.
Yeah, I mean... And I think it's really unusual that they are. I suppose for me, you know, and I've been sent quite a few scripts for movies, some of which are interesting. And I guess I can see them being really good films. I can see them being perfectly acceptable movies that people will pay money to see.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't see that they'll be innovative or interesting or groundbreaking or, you know, and I kind of feel like whether you end up doing something interesting and groundbreaking in the end, you can never know. But unless if you don't set out to do it,
mm-hmm.
you're never going to get anywhere near it. Do you know what I mean? If you don't set out to do something which is going to be a bit different, mm. you know. So I guess I am kind of looking, you know, kind of subjecting these things to a sort of fairly harsh sort of degree of like scrutiny. Does it have the potential to tell us something we didn't know, you know.
Of course, since you're a documentarian, we know you have enormous patience.
Yeah, it's part of the game, I guess, yeah.
So you'll wait until the right thing...
I think that's the smart thing to do, yeah.